This is Barry Bunnell, the former Manchester City and Crewe Alexandra youth coach, who all four players we spoke to this morning say abused them in the 1980s. He's been jailed three times for child sex abuse, including once in the United States. He was jailed most recently in 2015 for an historic sexual offence committed against a 12-year-old boy on a football pitch in Macclesfield. The police in Florida say he had an insatiable appetite for young boys. He himself described himself as a monster while giving evidence in court in 2015. This is him talking to the BBC back when he was a youth coach at Crewe in 1991.
We really work the kids up, they're learning all the time, and we do a lot of talking to them as well as showing them that their skills and explaining the game to them. But we explain that there's more to it than just coming here 1 hour a week. They need to, well, we give them homework.
Bunnell remains permanently suspended from football. The England captain, Wayne Rooney, is this morning encouraging any player who's been sexually abused during their careers to call a new dedicated football helpline so they no longer suffer in silence. The 24-hour NSPCC hotline number is 0800 023 2642. 0800 023 2642. We can speak now to three former players. Peter Shilton, England's most capped footballer, John Scales, former Liverpool and England defender, and Michael Bennett, former Charlton player, who's now the Professional Football Association's head of player welfare. John, I know you were watching the interviews earlier with the four guys. What did you think?
Well, first and foremost, I think, like everybody, just the courage and the bravery that they showed was incredibly powerful and moving. The emotional shock, I think, that we all felt watching that is nothing and pales into, you know, comparison with obviously the trauma that they're going through right now in revealing all that they are. But years and years of living with that and locking it away and not being able to process it, not being able to get into therapy to try and go through that lengthy process that in many ways is just starting now. It was hard watching, very, very difficult, very moving. And I felt, as a former professional footballer, you know, I've seen things in a dressing room, verbal abuse, physical abuse. You know, to hear those stories of sexual abuse and what those young players went through was just quite shocking and disturbing. And so my heart goes out to them and my support, you know, in whichever way you feel you want to support those players and that bravery to come out. They share that experience, which is going to help them in moving forward, obviously. It's a long process for them to come to terms with and the steps ahead now that they have revealed what they have. And I hope that, you know, all the authorities, relevant authorities, really come together and make that as a good a process as possible. And we ensure that this sort of thing doesn't ever happen again. But that brings it on to the whole sort of issue of where does it drive paedophiles that have been prevalent in the game in the past? Where does it drive them into the lower reaches of the game? The fear that we all as parents have about keeping our children safe. Very, very disturbing stories.
Peter, how do you respond?
Well, first of all, terrific respect for the lads there to come out, very brave to come out and, you know, tell about the abuse. I think you can't think of anything really worse to happen to you. And I think hopefully by doing what they've done, it's helped them a little bit because they've obviously suppressed it for years and years and years. I mean, and you know, to actually get it out into the open, hopefully they will gain some benefit from it first of all. But I think, you know, it is a society thing. You know, we've seen it in so many other areas just recently, entertainment in particular, but it is a society thing. But when it becomes into sport, you know, I think we've tended to turn a blind eye. And I think what happens is that, you know, young footballers, talking about football, you know, they really want to become footballers. You know, when they're young, they dream of it, their parents dream of it. And in some ways, they'll sort of, you know, do anything in a sense to try and achieve that. You know, they won't want to upset coaches. They won't want to upset people at clubs. And obviously, this is a bit of a license then for these paedophiles to, you know, to obviously do what they want to do. And you know, that it hasn't been good enough in the past in terms of, you know, bringing it out and having areas where, you know, obviously coaches are checked, but, you know, as one of the lads said earlier on, you know, some of them, you know, the checks will be great. It's when they actually get into the situation, what do you do then? Mm-hmm. And all you can do is give an area where, you know, the lads can actually, or the parents can actually, you know, ring and let people know what's going off. So overall, great credit to the boys, and hopefully from this there'll be a springboard to a lot of other things happening.
Michael, you've been involved, I know, in helping Andy and others who've been abused. Yeah. What is the nature of that help?
The nature of that help is that when individuals can come forward, we have a triage system in place that we find the relevant support recognised for them and get that process underway. In Andy's case, he came onto us October last year with a presenting issue, and obviously going through that therapy, this obviously is coming out from that. Mm. And it's given him the strength to now come forward and share what he's gone through with other people, and obviously the catalyst for Chris and Jason to come forward as well as Stephen. So yeah, that was a process. Mm.
Do you think it could happen now?
I'm hoping not. You know, with the safeguard and stuff that we've got in place now, it's very, very tightly done now. So I honestly don't think it could happen now.
Do you think we should have in law mandatory referrals? So if you suspect as an adult anything inappropriate is going on, you should be compelled to tell somebody, to report it.
I think so, yeah. I think that gives that individual that freedom to be able to express what they're going through and to have a source to go to do that. Mm. And I think that will make life much more easier for the individual that are going through that experience to share what they've encountered.
Right. John, what do you think about that? This idea that you should be compelled by legislation, if you suspect something, to report it?
It's all about having confidence. And my concern is that you've got to create an environment where people feel safe and confident that the institutional support, the institutional rigour will be there to back that up. And as we've seen in the independent inquiry into child sexual abuse, the chaos that finds itself in destroys confidence that the process will be robust, that you will be believed, that you will be safe and you know, in an environment where you can share those things in confidence. And I absolutely agree that that's probably the right step to take, that it does become mandatory. How that actually works in practice will have to be really well thought through and ensure that those victims feel that they are getting the absolute adequate support in so many areas. It's not just about disclosure, it's about the support then and the confidence that they have in that process.
Stay with us, gentlemen, because in the light of these revelations, we've been taking a look at what measures might be taken to keep children safe.
It's the most popular game in the world. 8 million people play football in this country. But after the recent revelations of historic abuse, how vulnerable is the game today, and what's being done to protect young children?
My concern is not looking back, it's looking what we can do now and what we can do to put in place to protect these children, even at grassroots.
It is important that we do not ignore a single thing. From 2001, the Football Association put in place new rules. People we've spoken to say it was well ahead of other sports on this.
And what if you feel the situation is more serious?
Each team, from the smallest to professional outfits, must now have a trained safeguarding or welfare officer. Anyone who works with under-18s must have a criminal record check. That's more than 50,000 a season.
Keep it safe.
The FA says this will screen out anyone who may pose a risk. Others say it's far from a guarantee.
What we know about abuse is that people don't talk about it. They don't come forward. It's a crime that is covered in silence. And so there very often isn't a criminal record.
Critics of the current system say it relies too much on children being able to come forward and report abuse. In other countries, they have stricter rules.
The new portrait emerging of the Penn State football coach accused of abusing 8 young boys.
In the US, a senior football coach was recently convicted of 45 counts of child abuse. But 3 other men at the university involved, Penn State, are still awaiting trial for failing to tell the authorities about their suspicions.
He too never contacted police or kept sending...
Some form of that protection, called mandatory reporting, is in place in most other countries. It makes it a criminal offence not to come forward and report neglect if you have a reasonable suspicion it's going on.
Introducing mandatory reporting increases both the number of reports but also the number of reports that are substantiated.
Others, though, think mandatory reporting has its limitations and could lead to police being overwhelmed with reports of abuse that later prove false. The government is now considering whether to tighten the law, with the final decision due next year.
Well, let's speak now to Labour's sports spokesperson, Dr. Rosanna Allen-Khan. John Nicholson is here from the SNP. He sits on the Culture, Media and Sport Select Committee. Tom Perry is here too, an abuse survivor and campaigner who wants to introduce mandatory reporting, which you heard about from Jim just then. Also still with us, three former players, Peter Shilton, John Scales and Michael Bennett. Tom, mandatory reporting, why is it essential in your view?
Well, I'm the founder of the pressure group Mandate Now, so we're easily findable. Why is it important? At the moment, we're one of the few countries in the world that doesn't have it. Just to give you some idea, to get the scale of all this, 72% of Asian countries have it, 74% of African countries have it, some form of mandatory reporting, 86% of Europe and 90% of the Americas. But apparently the government keeps telling us we've got it right. Well, quite clearly, you know, given the fact that we now have the independent inquiry into child sexual abuse, we've had these extraordinary revelations in sport, we haven't got it right.
So what would mandatory reporting mean in practical terms?
In practical terms, we're following precedent that exists elsewhere, principally in Australia, I'd say, where it operates so well. We want to see anyone who has a suspicion on reasonable grounds to report that to a triage service. Now, that actually, in principle, is operating now in this country. The only problem is it is discretionary to report. It is not mandatory to report.
Would the SNP support that?
I'm not entirely sure how that would work. So
if you had a suspicion on reasonable grounds, you'd have to tell the police.
Yes, but is there a penalty if you don't? And if so, what's the penalty?
Now that's very interesting, because yes, there is a penalty, and the penalty actually is a fine through magistrates' court. This is all set out in our submission, where we drafted the legislation for the government for the government's consideration. And it is there very clearly. So these matters.
So you'd criminalise someone who didn't report, who had a suspicion on reasonable grounds.
On reasonable grounds.
And what happens, for example? Yes. Because I'm interested in your proposal. But what happens, for example, if you're talking about a 17-year-old boy or an 18-year-old young adult who knows that his 15-year-old mate is being abused? Would that 18-year-old boy then be subject to criminal penalties if he himself feels intimidated and doesn't want to come forward?
No, not at all, because that indicates that you don't quite understand the system that is operating in England. In England, what happens is, with children under the age of 18 years old, if there is an offence by someone who is defined as a child under the age of 18, who is in an educational setting, working in a regulated activity, because we are talking about mandatory reporting only in regulated activities, which includes sport, includes schools, includes faith settings. What happens is that gets referred to Children's Services, and this protocol exists now, and Children's Services address that. We're not seeking to criminalise a 17-year-old.
But if you're 18, and in that situation, you could be subject to criminal penalties.
No, not if you're within a regulated activity, because we are only applying mandatory reporting to regulated activities.
I see.
As defined by the Safeguarding Vulnerable Groups Act 2006.
Okay. Rosanna, would you support that?
I would. I think we need a robust, well-designed system. We have a duty to protect our children.
So we don't have that now, is the implication?
We don't. I don't believe that we do. I think it's about two things. It's about having a robust, well-designed system, but also creating a safe space for people to come forward and say when they're concerned. But I must preface this by saying that 99.9% of coaches and officials work hard, they have the children's best interests at heart.
But
we have to crack down on sexual predators.
Yeah. I mean, Tom, you are a survivor of abuse. Just how difficult is it to speak up?
I kept quiet about it for a mere 38 years.
Goodness.
Okay? And I have to tell you, it is incredibly difficult. It is an absolute life changer to many people. Not everybody, but to me it certainly is. I have to tell you that living a life where I have no respect for authority, and to be frank with you, anyone carrying a clipboard walking towards me is in deep trouble without realizing it, because it is a statement of authority, and it is a problem. And frankly, the cost of child abuse, I mean, the NSPCC has done some research on this and estimates conservatively, I have to say we do question it, as we do rather a lot of things about the NSPCC, if I'm frank with you, the cost of it, they estimated in 2012, was $3.2 billion. This goes into police, court service, drug addiction, crime. It just and mental health services, of which I have taken part of, I said it came out in a group that I was involved in that seven out of nine people had been abused in childhood. I asked the principal psychologist if this was common, and they said, "Well, it's almost the default. Were it not for child abuse, frankly, we would have space."
John Nicholson, from your committee's point of view, your chairman has written to the FA. Do you have any steer on how widespread this might be in terms of historical claims? And are you satisfied the FA is taking this seriously enough now, even if it wasn't then?
Well, of course, 20 years ago, there was a dispatches programme which looked at this on Channel 4, and the recommendation was that the FA should take it very seriously indeed. That was back in 1997.
And they wouldn't even comment at the time.
Precisely. We now know that this hotline has been set up and what, over 50 people have called it almost immediately. That was the figure yesterday.
Yes, that was on this programme, in the first 2 hours, 50.
It is clearly a huge problem. So what our select committee has done is write to the FA, find out what the FA's action plan is. We're keen to have the FA in to speak to us about this and then decide how we're going to take it forward.
Okay.
Because it's obviously an enormous problem, not least because what we've heard today is what we all know from our friends and our family, from our constituents, that kids are often scared to tell their parents. They don't want to upset their parents, I think, is a huge problem.
I just want to ask our former players, Chris, Jason, Andy and Steve said, you know, they thought there were adults who knew what was going on. I want to ask you, Michael, have you heard rumours? Had you heard about suspicions?
In regards to what was going on?
Yeah. Without naming any names, obviously.
When you were playing, you heard rumours. And a number of players will say the same thing, but without any evidence you can't do anything. So yes, the rumours were there, but as I said, no one wasn't brave enough then to step forward and come forward with those allegations, and that's why we're here today, because these guys are now
I'm interested in knowing that, because we've both been around the BBC for a while. There was always rumours, weren't there, about Jimmy Savile, but hard evidence was quite a different thing.
Yeah, well,
the kids talk to other kids?
Well, I asked Andy, Steve, and Chris, precisely, and Jason, and they didn't talk to each other. There would be a look. They would exchange a look with their eye, purely through eye contact, but they did not speak about it.
You don't, and can I tell you why? Because it's very important. Very few people mention this, because as kids, when you are abused and the abuse is repeated, okay, it's a very dangerous word, this, but this is it. You feel complicit, and complicity silences you.
Right. Peter, did you, again, without naming any names, in your long and distinguished playing career, did you hear rumours? Did you hear suspicions? Were there particular clubs where players said, I think that might be going on?
No, not really. Not on the abuse side. It was more, I think, maybe that, you know, one or two players may be gay, but not on the abuse side. I think, just here, very, very, you know, I think we've got to be very careful that, you know, when we're talking about coaches, and we're talking about boys really on this, I mean, I know that there may be some adults or teenagers involved, but I think obviously the coaches in this country, somebody just alluded to it, that, you know, 99% or 98%, whatever percentage you want, you know, are great people who really do a great job. And we've got to be very careful that we don't stigmatise, you know, the coaches of kids. You know, this is a very small minority that do this. But, you know, I think we've obviously, going forward, we've got to make sure that the people who have been abused, who maybe feel they can come forward now, there's a great platform for them to get help. And these, as I say, these brave lads who have come forward will help in that. Obviously, going with the people in the future, we've got to put, obviously, a lot tighter regulation in. I mean, the FA years ago is nothing like today. I mean, a lot of things were brushed under the carpet. You know, things weren't discussed. I mean, the FA now is more open. As we see, they put a hotline in, which is which is somebody just said there was 50 odd calls yesterday. So they are more progressive in this, but I think years ago maybe it was just brushed under the carpet and it's not supposed to happen.
Yeah.
And as I said earlier on, youngsters, you know, they want to become footballers, their parents do. And it's even if they know there's rumours, they won't want to sort of put their kid in jeopardy in case, you know, he gets thrown out of the club or something. So there's all these things to consider.
Rosanna Ali Khan, I wonder if you think these historical sexual abuse claims in football should be brought into the National Child Sexual Abuse Inquiry.
I think they should. I think we need to do absolutely whatever we can to stop this happening. I mean, I'm a mother myself, and I know up and down the country, parents are going to be frightened. Children, young adults are going to be frightened about what it means for them to come out, what it means to take their child somewhere and leave them unaccompanied. And I think it's really, really important. I mean, I've spoken to the FA, I've been in discussion with them already, and they have been working very, very hard recently to have designated safeguarding officers. But we need to make sure that these safeguarding officers, that are quite often a parent, have robust training. They need proper training. And I would really welcome any measures that it would take to ensure that there's a safe platform for people to come out and report.
John, final thought. Did you, again, without naming any names, did you hear rumours when you were playing?
Yeah, I heard very clear rumours. And the clubs that we've been discussing through, there was always, you know, innuendo and things said. And, you know, we heard all the other stories and all other, the other sort of fanciful rumours about players and everything else. I did also hear rumours about players themselves, senior players, abusive, aggressive, and saw that firsthand to other players. And therefore, that was also the issue. So you come back the full circle that those youngsters almost grow up in an environment where they feel that this is part and parcel of playing football, being in this environment, that, as the gentleman said before, if you don't accept it, and the guilt you feel and the complicity that you feel in it, makes you feel compelled that is just part and parcel of the environment in which you're in.
Okay.
For me, I'm scared to death of my children now at the age of 7 and 10 going off into ballet, jazz, swimming, athletics, wherever they are. And we look at people, look at coaches, look at those people in those positions of power and influence with an eye of suspicion on every single one of them. And that's a horrible place to be, but that's the world in which we live in. And therefore, you know, it's all well and good saying, you know, football has this problem. I think we all appreciate society has this problem of paedophiles extensively at large in this country and across the world. And there has to be a process that's put into place that safeguards those youngsters much better. I think the mandatory reporting is a good step, as long as it's implemented in the right way. But I think politicians have got to be careful about sort of saying all these fantastic new systems be put in without the rigour of learning the lessons and sort of passing the blame towards the FA. The FA 20 years ago is a very different organisation than the FA is today. We saw the way they came out with the NSPCC and put this helpline together and put that where players can come forward. My fear is that football has the resources to be able to put these into place and into action. My concern is that these minor sports with very little funding and are unable to do that. And therefore, how do you, without the money or the resource of those other sports, do we push paedophiles out of that tier of the game of football, where the money and the resources are able to look after the welfare of youngsters, and we push those predators into other areas, and we never break the cycle.
Tom, final word.
Terribly. Very simply, 40 years ago, there's no need for anyone to report the witness rape of a child in a regulated activity. Today, nothing has changed. Until it changes, there is going to be no improvement to child protection. Mandatory reporting is a vital component of a functioning child protection system, and we've got to have it.
Okay. And the government gives the outcome of its consultation
in December, and they don't want it.
They don't want it.
They do not want it.
You know that before the consultation has come out.
Absolutely. Look at the bias in the consultation paper.
Okay.
They even omitted the most important piece of research that was published in April by Professor Ben Matthews of the Australian Institute of Technology, and it was a 7-year longitudinal study of a single jurisdiction and the effects of the introduction.
I'll talk to the sports minister about this tomorrow.
Good.
See what she has to say.
Right.
Football's doing what we're doing.
The Labour team take it incredibly seriously.
Okay. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Hello, good morning. It's Friday, the 25th of November. I'm Anita McVeigh and welcome to BBC Newsroom Live. Two more former footballers have waived their right to anonymity to tell BBC News they were abused as children by a coach. The interviews on the Victoria Derbyshire programme, in which Chris Unsworth and Jason Dunford spoke publicly for the first time, come at the end of a week of revelations that have shocked football. Both Unsworth and Dunford suffered at the hands of Barry Bennell, a coach at Crewe Alexandra in the 1980s and 1990s. Bennell, who's 62, was jailed in 1998 for 9 years and also served a 4-year sentence in the United States. Last year, he was given a 2-year term for sexually abusing a boy at a training camp in Cheshire, but he's now out of prison. While Chris Unsworth, who played for Crewe and Man City, says he was raped up to 100 times. He didn't tell anyone about the abuse for more than 30 years until he saw another former player, Andy Woodward, speaking last week. Jason Dunford, and with me now is our sports news correspondent, Richard Conway. Richard, hugely powerful accounts by these men of what happened to them. Incredibly brave, incredibly courageous of them to talk in this way. Given that they come from a world where perhaps talking about one's feelings isn't necessarily the dumb thing.
Exactly. You know, what we've seen over the past few days and in such stark and powerful terms there on the Victoria Derbyshire show this morning is that veil of secrecy within football that we see so often being lifted. There has been a movement this week, starting with Andy Woodward, who spoke out first of all, and it's followed on in what we heard this morning from those four former players was the abuse they'd suffered at the hands of Barry Bennell, a former coach at Crewe. And you can sense the relief that they are experiencing by talking about this, by confronting it, but also the emotion that they're feeling as well in having to drag up those memories. But it has prompted others to come forward. We've seen Paul Stewart, the former England and Tottenham player, who said he suffered abuse from at the hands of another coach, which he hasn't named, and others as well coming forward to the Guardian newspaper today, a former Newcastle United player, talking about his experiences. So it does seem as if this has a momentum. It does feel as if other players, perhaps having heard the testimony from those who have come forward this week, may now be emboldened enough and courageous enough to speak out about their experience.
And as we know, Richard, the Football Association met yesterday. It sent out letters to clubs around the country. It does feel as though there's a momentum behind this now, that the FA has to seize this momentum and take this opportunity to try to ensure that the safeguarding is in place, that the parents who are sending their kids all around the UK to football training know those children will be safe.
Yeah, and I think the sense of that has really hit home at the Football Association this week. Greg Clark, the chairman, speaking last night and saying that he had sent a letter to 30,000 football clubs, amateur, professional, at all levels of the game within England that come under their jurisdiction to remind them of their responsibilities on safeguarding, to remind them that there is to be no let-up in being vigilant. The NSPCC, of course, are heavily involved in this. They have worked in conjunction with the FA this week to set up a helpline that received 50 calls, we're told, in the first 2 hours of operation yesterday. 20 of those calls have been passed on to the police to be followed up. So a sense from the FA of their responsibilities, and also I think from the Professional Footballers Association. But in the back of all this, we have players like Andy Woodward who have said when they did speak out and when they were talking to the authorities before going public, they didn't feel that they had the full support of the game of football behind them. I think perhaps what we're seeing now is the authorities realising that they have to take this seriously, they have to act on this because of the responsibilities that they have to the game and to the children who play it.
Disappointing for those men that they didn't feel they had that full backing until they took the step of going public. Do you have any sense, Richard, of what the scale of this might be? As you said, it's likely that more former footballers will come forward now.
Well, listening to the testimony of the players who have spoken this week, the one thing that comes across is that they knew of others. They were in houses of their abusers with other young children who were being abused. There was a knowledge that it wasn't just them, that they were not alone. And clearly, what we've heard from Andy Woodward and others is that Barry Bennell, just to take one coach that we know about, was involved and touched the lives of hundreds of children and when in the clubs that he was involved with. So their feeling, and we've heard from them this morning, is saying that this could number into the hundreds and it could rival other serious child abuse investigations that have gone in other spheres and other walks of life.
OK, Richard, thank you very much. Richard Conway. And you'll be able to watch more of Victoria Derbyshire's interviews with those former footballers in special programmes at 12:30 and 8:30 here on BBC News. Now, searing criticism has been levelled at Scotland Yard as it's accused of putting children at risk because of its serious failings in handling child abuse. The Inspectorate of Constabulary found that three-quarters of cases investigated by the force were dealt with inadequately or needed improvement. It said there was an indefensible lack of leadership in child protection with no single officer in charge. The Metropolitan Police has apologised and said it will use the report as a launchpad for reform. This report from Richard Slee.
This report contains some of the most scathing criticism ever for a police force from its watchdog. It found that nearly three-quarters of the 374 cases it examined were inadequately handled. There were unacceptable delays in obtaining evidence and a failure to take some cases of missing children seriously, with local officers often unaware of registered sex offenders living in their area. Inspectors also referred 38 of the cases they examined back to the force because of concerns there could be a continuing risk to children.
What we don't have evidence for, because we weren't looking for, is any specific crimes or damage to children that happened as a result of these failings. What we can say with confidence is that children were kept at risk, at higher risk, for longer than they should have been, and were put in more danger than they should have been.
The Metropolitan Police has apologised for its failings and says it's already identified a number of areas that need improvement.
This report says some really challenging things to us about investigations that we have not done as well as we could have done. And we need to look at that and we need to learn from that. And we need to use this to build on the work that we're already doing to try and make our services as protective as we can for children.
This is the third time, though, in as many weeks that the competence and judgment of Met officers have been called into question. There were failings identified in Operation Midland, the inquiry into an alleged high-level paedophile ring, and claims emerged that the serial killer Stephen Port could have been caught earlier. The Met will be inspected again next year to see if it's succeeding in providing better protection for children in London. Richard Slee, BBC News.
Well, joining me now from our central London studio is Matt Parr from Her Majesty's Inspector of Constabulary, who you saw in that report. Thank you very much for your time today. Your findings are absolutely shocking, aren't they, given especially that we are in an era where there's no excuse for any organisation, let alone Britain's biggest police force, to not know what its duties are in terms of looking after children.
Yes, I agree. That's why we've been going through all the forces in England and Wales, looking specifically at how they deal with child protection. Of the 43 forces, we've done 13 so far. The Metropolitan Police is the latest. And what we've issued is a comprehensive, yes, quite shocking and very hard-hitting critical report.
You say there was an indefensible lack of leadership in child protection with no single officer in charge. Were you able to identify how that situation arose?
Well, I think it's just the way that the Met has been structured. In contrast to all the other forces we've looked at, who did have a senior officer as lead for child protection, nowhere in the top five ranks in the Met was there a single police officer with this responsibility. Now, you might say that doesn't matter, but it kind of manifests itself when you see that there's inconsistent practice between boroughs, training that's been missed, people not being properly prepared for their roles, the correct basic procedures not being covered out across London to the standard that we would expect and we think the public have a right to expect.
And I think most people would say that and certainly recognise that that does matter, to have a clear person in charge. And 384 cases you looked at, 38 of those were immediately referred back to the Met because you believe that children could still be at risk. So the Inspectorate identified something that the Met hadn't identified.
Yes, that's right. The Met looked at the same case file history that we did, those hundreds of files. The Met graded three-quarters of them essentially quite good, We graded them exactly the opposite way, three quarters of them just not good enough. And I think we had to point out in those 38 cases that they'd made some bad judgments about how much risk was being carried in those cases. And you're right, we sent 38 cases back to be reopened, re-established and pursued properly because we thought that children were at risk in those cases.
If the Met Commissioner wasn't already stepping down from his position, would you be calling on him to go because of this?
Well, it's not the job of the inspectorate to get involved in the appointments of senior officers. I think it's well established that the current commissioner, has announced his retirement. He goes at the end of February. Actually, he'd announced his retirement before he saw this report.
But has anyone been sanctioned over this? Because it is disgraceful, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it's a failing of the Met as a whole. I wouldn't want to try and pin it on any one individual. I mean, there's some really good people in the Met who care a lot about child protection, and some of what we saw was very, very sound practice, I think, particularly in the specialist team that deals with the more serious end of it. I wouldn't want us to have a blame game. What's most important to us is that the Met takes the appropriate steps now to put things right, get the standards to where we want them to do.
Just finally, how quickly will you expect it to put things right, and what sort of checks will you be making on them to make sure that they do that?
Well, there's no magic bullet. They're not going to change it overnight, but there are some actions we want to see in the way they organise overnight. I'm pleased to see that they've already announced Martin Hewitt, the Assistant Commissioner, to have this lead. So they're stepping in the right direction, but we're going to stay very closely engaged with them to make sure that this Get Well programme works properly.
OK, Matt Parr from Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary. Thank you very much for your time today.
And him manoeuvring his way to see me every day almost.
People who haven't been abused often don't understand that process, that grooming process. They don't understand why a young lad who understands that this is wrong doesn't go running straight to mum and dad or straight to the police. But he was in a position of authority. There was a degree of trust, one presumes, between you two.
Yes, and, you know, when you're young and you want to become a footballer, which is all I ever wanted to do, and you are told that these are the things you need to do. If you say anything, I will kill your parents and your two brothers, then it's very difficult not to believe at that age. That will be carried through. So that's when it becomes difficult because they ingrace themselves to your family whilst behind the scenes they're abusing you sexually.
So this individual, not only did he threaten to take away your dreams of, you know, professional football, but actually threatened to hurt you and those closest to you?
Yes, he threatened a number of times that if I ever said anything that he would kill my two brothers and my parents.
And what of the other players in your team? Was this abuse limited to you, or were there others close to you? Do you know that he was also abusing?
I know of two others that were abused. One in the same team. One came 2 or 3 years later. I have spoken to, not recently, but in the past. About not particularly about the abuse, but just that we acknowledge what went on and we know what we've been through.
Of course, you have now chosen to speak out of this, and we all now know, of course, obviously, about Benel and the crimes that he committed. But what went you through your head in making the, I have to say, incredibly brave decision to actually go public with this?
I saw the article that Andy Woodward wrote. I think it broke last Friday. Initially, I was going to contact the paper straight away, but I then realised that I've got my wife, my children, my parents who are still alive. I needed to make sure that they were comfortable with me making these, as you call them, allegations before I went public, because at that time I hadn't really discussed it in any detail with anybody since it happened 41 years ago.
How has that been? That's, you know, four decades of living with this. It must have been so difficult. Of course, you mean you're so close to your family, you're so close to your partner. How has that been to actually have had to force that down inside you?
I think probably they've suffered more than I have over many years. I got into drugs and became addicted to drugs. I turned to drink on many occasions, and I've been unable to show any sort of emotion to my children or to my wife in the form of saying that I love you or putting my arms around them. So it has been, it's been very difficult over the 41 years, but they just seem to have accepted that that's Dad and that's the way that Dad is. And I feel in a way so guilty for them having to suffer and endure my problems over the years that we've been together.
Just how prevalent do you think abuse of children has been in football over the years? We hear from the FA and from others that there are safeguards now in place, but those safeguards have only been in place for a number of years.
Yeah, I think that it was very prevalent when I was young. It just wasn't so widely spoke about, almost taboo, and you would find sometimes if somebody did come forward, they almost were blamed for it because it is normally somebody close to you, and they would side with the adult rather than the child. So I do believe now, with the exposure, that it's more openly spoke about. But when I was young, it was almost, you know, a taboo subject.
We are, of course, seeing more people phoning the NSPCC line as a result of your words, those of Andy Woodward and everyone else who's now being so brave as to speak out. The Professional Footballers Association has said that they would want to see a full inquiry into what has been going on in the youth game in this country. I don't want to presume that this is something you would agree with. What are your views on a root and branch review of what happened, as you yourself say, you know, a number of decades ago?
I don't think a review or anything that is still in the news is going to do this any harm, because if it only stops a few people thinking about approaching any level of sport, because I think it's a praying ground for paedophiles to get access to young people. So the fact that the PFA decided to do anything will keep it at the forefront of the news. It will encourage people to come forward and tell their story, and hopefully, you know, I don't totally think they'll ever eradicate it, because these people are so manipulative, they will find other ways to get access to young children. But it can only do good rather than harm.
I'm afraid to say, I think I agree with you. And Paul, thank you very much for joining us here in Sky News today. We really do appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Searing report by Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary into the Met Police and how it handled child protection issues. We heard there from the policing minister also criticising the Met over its failings. And we can talk now to Jim Gamble. He is the former and founding chief executive of the CEOP Centre, the Child Exploitation and Online Protection Centre. He joins us from our Belfast studio. Jim, thank you very much for your time today. I'd also, if I may, like to bring in these related issues of the footballers who have been revealing the abuse they suffered as young children at the hands of coaches. Perhaps if we begin with that. They've been extremely courageous, haven't they, in coming forward? We know that the FA, the NSPCC, now wants to try to encourage others who may have suffered to come forward, and for the FA to try to ensure that this can't happen again. What are your thoughts on all of these issues?
Well, I think, first of all, to talk about those people who have suffered in the past coming forward is important, and I think the Metropolitan Police did extremely well post-Savile in Operation Yew Tree, when they had a victim-centred approach and encouraged people to come forward. So balance is key. I think those that have come forward from the football environment have shown real courage, and they've been able to create an environment where these discussions take place and we can encourage more people. And thankfully, we have the likes of the NSPCC there with their helplines. So I would encourage anyone who's been carrying a burden of pain, this legacy, because of non-recent abuse, abuse they suffered as a child, to think about it. If they're ready, if they feel the time is right, come forward and talk to the NSPCC. They'll be able to unpack some of that pain, and actually through the NSPCC, they'll be able to share their experience in a way that the police and others can learn. Because learning from the mistakes of the past is the only way we're going to protect children in the future. And that's why the HMIC report is so important. Many people don't like overly critical inspection reports, and I understand that, having been involved myself. But ultimately, it's about looking at the detail and learning. And I think when you get beyond the unhelpful and sensational headline that actually the HMIC put on the report themselves, when you get into the detail, there's much to be learned.
Is it unfair for you to say that it is an unhelpful and sensational headline when the Met Police, of all the forces that HMIC has inspected so far, and indeed it is the largest force in Britain, was the only one not to have a single named person in charge of these child protection issues? Surely in this era, that is unacceptable.
Well, of course it is. And I think criticism, evidence criticism, is absolutely right. And I think the HMIC report is timely. And I think policing across the UK will learn from it. It's the nature of a tabloid headline on the front of an HMIC report that I think is unhelpful. But what I'm saying here is, if you read the detail of the report, which is constructive, it's obvious that police, and not just the Metropolitan Police, have a difficulty looking at child protection in the context of safeguarding rather than in the context of a simple criminal justice outcome. So there's lots of learning. The thing that worries me...
How do they change that? How do they change the way they look at this then?
Well, I think they need to move to look at children's lives in context. The child's life at home, the child's life in school, in health, and amongst their friends, and both on and offline. And you can see by reading the detail of what is a very insightful and forensic HMI report that they've looked at individuals who are suspects. They've taken too long on some occasions to go and interdict their behaviour. And when they have focused on them, they haven't considered the wider implications of their relationship with children in their home or children that they may have access to through their job. And that's about a broader safeguarding issue. And in the current context, when we've got a bill going through Parliament that's going to do away with local safeguarding children boards, then you've got to become even more concerned, because partnership is key. And as the HMIC recognises themselves, policing alone cannot deliver safeguarding children, especially in an environment which is now fundamentally integrated with a digital world.
But in a line, the Met needs to do an awful lot more, and it needs to do it quickly. It needs to change its practices very quickly.
Of course it does. But as the independent chair of the City and Hackney Safeguarding Children Board, the work that I see being done by local police for local children doesn't reflect the criticism, the justified criticism in HMIC. The Met is too fragmented. It's got plans for 2020. It's already moving towards change. I'm not trying to defend the indefensible. What I'm saying is we need constructive and considered improvement. And can I just say this? We're, you know, at a time in history, post-Savile, post the recent football issues, you know, looking at policing who are struggling to come to terms with modern safeguarding in the world that's digitally engaged. And we've got the Child Sex Abuse Inquiry being led by Professor Jay. That inquiry concerns me more than anything else, because it's the one time, the one moment in time when we really need to be able to collect all of the information that's available, analyse it and learn lessons about the past so that we don't repeat them in the future. And what seems to be happening through the way that's being managed, there was a bungled beginning, we've had several chairs, but even now, where we hear that allegations were made, rumours abounded about inappropriate or abusive behaviour or bullying behaviour, that wasn't immediately investigated. And it seems to be that that's only now being addressed as a serious issue. Post the letter from Hugh Davis QC, an individual I know and respect well, and the pressure from the Home Affairs Select Committee, that doesn't sound to me like a child sex abuse inquiry that is fit for purpose. We can no longer let survivors of abuse down. They're watching in the margins. Every time this happens, every time someone takes the courage to come forward, we need to support them.
And you raise very important issues. Just want to bring this conversation back to the area of football. You know, given your experience in this area and what you know about Savile and that area, other entertainers who were found guilty of the abuse of children, what is your sense about what we are seeing now in the world of football and sport generally? Do you think this inquiry could become a really extensive one, with more people coming forward, more people being implicated?
Yes, I think it could grow. And the reason is because sporting environments, let's move away from just simply football, whether it's rugby, whether it's tennis, whether it's swimming, the key ingredients are young people who aspire to be something special, placed in proximity with individuals they admire because of their sporting prowess or semi-celebrity. That creates an environment that is perfect for the abuser because it's built on trust and proximity. That's why I think this is the tip of the iceberg, and I hope that other people, and I know many cases, be it in swimming, be it in athletics, be it in rugby, where people have been abused. If you're sitting, listening or watching this program and you are that person, if you're ready, you know, talk to your GP, talk to an adult you can trust. And if you feel you're ready now, talk to the NSPCC, because you can make a difference. The more people that come forward, the more pressure we'll be able to bring to bear on government to get its act together, so that policing, so that children's social care, so that the multi-agency partnership that's there to make our children safer in future can work better.
OK, Jim Gamble, thank you very much. Jim Gamble there, former chief executive of the Child Exploitation and Online Protection Centre.
Three former youth players exclusively tell us about the abuse they say they suffered at the hands of their former coach, Barry Bunnell, a convicted paedophile. Since Andy Woodward told us last week in his first broadcast interview that he'd been raped hundreds of times by Bunnell whilst at Crewe Alexandra, in total, six other players have now come forward to waive their right to anonymity. And we can speak to three of them now. Chris Unsworth says he was raped between 50 and 100 times by Bunnell at Manchester City and Crewe youth teams. He didn't tell a single person about the abuse for over 30 years until, in fact, he saw our interview with Andy Woodward last week. Jason Dunford says he was abused once by Bunnell at the Manchester City youth team, and when he told him to get off, Bunnell effectively forced him out of the club. Neither of them turned professional, in part, they say, because of Bunnell's abuse. They're both speaking publicly for the very first time today. Steve Walters says he was repeatedly abused by Bunnell whilst at Crewe. This is his first TV interview. And with them is Andy Woodward, the player whose revelations have inspired others to speak out at last. As you'd expect, our conversation with them is going to be frank, it's going to be open, and it will cover details of sexual abuse. First of all, let me thank you so much for coming on the programme today. We really, really appreciate you talking to our audience. Chris, I'm going to start with you. When you first watched the interview with Andy last week, what effect did it have on you?
A massive effect, really. Just watching Andy on TV, I was just at home with my girlfriend, who actually watched the TV interview and brought it home, and we sat down and watched it. I didn't say anything apart from I knew Andy. I used to play with Andy. We had a little chat. She asked me if I was okay, then I came home and I sat at home and thought about this, and I thought, I've got to come forward. Got to come forward and help everybody.
You had never told a soul?
No. Never told anyone. Kept it locked away right in the back of my head, and still I'm reliving things. Having a chat with the boys and reliving it. Nope, never told a soul.
You were first introduced to Bunnell when he was a scout at Manchester City. How did his abuse of you begin?
It began, he used to pick me up. I was probably one of the closest lads that lived to his house.
In the Peak District.
In the Peak District. Yeah. He used to pick me up, and the abuse started in the car. He used to touch, we used to play games in the car, and that's when it all started.
Mm. And that would be on the way to training?
On the way to training and on the way back.
Right. And then he invited you to stay over at his house?
Yeah, that happened a little bit later, but not long after. At first, there was, you know, two, three, four lads that used to stay there. And there was always two or three in the bed.
Right. And I'm going to ask you, Chris, what he did to you.
At first, it started, you know, the games used to start, and it was hands everywhere, then down the pants. And then later, it got more serious in the bedroom, where there was penetration, things like that.
And what age were you?
I was about 9.
And what did you as a little boy think was going on?
I didn't know what was going on, to be fair. I knew where I wanted to get, and I thought, this is obviously what I've got to go through.
Did you know it was wrong? What he was doing was wrong?
I knew it was wrong, but I just went with it. Just went with it.
Did you ever consider telling a friend, a teammate, another adult?
No, never.
Why?
It just wasn't the in thing to do. It just wasn't the in thing to do. And you set your goals where you want to get to. And it was never brought up. Never.
He stopped after a few years, as you got older, sort of 13,
yeah,
14.
When you get a bit older and you're growing up, you're a young adult, your body changes. That's when your time really is it with him. Move on to fresh blood, as they say.
To younger boys, effectively.
Yeah, to younger boys.
When you got to 15, 16, you turned your back on football.
I did, yeah. I turned my back on football, and I was lucky. Saying lucky, is that the right word? I had other sports to pursue, and I turned professional golfer. So I had a sight, and I had a goal, and that was my escape route.
Right. And you turned your back on football because you associated it with this horror?
Yeah, somebody asked me that yesterday. At the time, I don't know. Was I good enough? I don't know. Looking back, I'd say yes. I probably turned football. I just had enough. That was it.
I can't imagine what it's like for a young boy growing up through adolescence into adulthood, and for decades keeping this kind of cataclysmic secret.
No. I chatted with my friend the other night about this, and you just get on with your life and you forget everything that has happened. As I say, luckily, I had my golf to go to, and that guided me through, I think. But both my parents have died, and that hurts me.
Yeah.
Not telling them.
Does it?
Yeah. But I don't know if it's a good thing that I did or I didn't tell them, because they would have blamed themselves, so.
Chris, thank you for telling us such personal, intimate and also horrific details. I want to bring in Steve, if I may. I wonder, Steve, what the effect on you has been of revealing this secret.
It's been like a massive relief after seeing Andy, how brave he's been last week. You know, the article in the Guardian. I was in the house on my own. I read it. I was inconsolable. I thought it was kind of a panic attack, because it was virtually the same scenario as me, and it's just somehow picked the phone up and phoned the newspaper because I was that hangry, upset. And but in another way, it was like the biggest, like I said to Andy, it was like a 100 tons lift off my shoulders.
Really?
Yeah, because to carry, you know, I've been carrying this all my life. You know, my career has been ruined. My relationships have been ruined. And like, you know, just I had to get it out there because, you know, I've got, you know, I've got children. This could never ever happen to any more children. Mm.
You had a reputation as being one of the finest young footballers in the country as a teenager.
That's right. Yeah. You know, people say to me, you know, what happened to you, Steve? And like, in a football environment, it's full of bravado and men. And like, you know, we've all met last night. You know, and our stories, and you know, we're all the same. Mm. I can't believe how brave we've all been there, and it's just.
Think he effectively snatched your footballing career away from you?
Well, yeah, that's what happened.
Yeah.
You know, it's simple as that. You know, what disappointed me really is, like, for Alexandria, you know, I come from Plymouth, and you know, my dad's dead now, but. He ended up working at Crewe as well, and you know, my parents put trust into that football club, and basically they've let us down, all of us.
Can you explain to our audience, Steve, why you were afraid to tell anyone?
I've had problems with relationships with men because I've always thought that. I've always thought, you know. Am I gay? You know, what's happened to us is, you know, he's made us feel like that. Mm. You know, that's not right. You know, it's affected every single relationship I've had with anybody. Like, but it's just so hard to explain. It's so difficult, honestly.
In the early 90s, the police did talk to you, didn't they?
Yes.
When they started to investigate Barry Bunnell,
they come to my house on three separate occasions, and you know, my career was, you know, I got told that I was never going to play football again. Mm. So, you know, somehow I managed to carry on. I'd end up playing in the conference for Northwich Victoria, but you know, I still wanted that dream of trying to. I wanted to fight this and beat this, and you know. If I did come out, it wouldn't, you know, would people believe you? Would people, you know, back in that day and age, if you come out with this sort of accusations, so to speak, would anybody believe you? And then would you get the support that we've had at the moment? Mm. You know, back then you just did not know.
No. Jason, compared to Andy, Steve and Chris, you describe yourself as lucky. Explain to our audience why you say that.
I feel I'm lucky because at the moment of what is determined now as sexual assault, I told him where to go. I confronted him, and as I saw the boys last night, I'll never forget the deathly stare.
Mm. And this was in his house?
No, this was in a holiday camp.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, at Butlins. Mm. And that stare was one of. I can never, ever forget that stare, but from that day forward, I knew my life was going to be really difficult with this guy.
Because you told him to effectively
I told him to go.
Where to go.
I told him to F off.
Yeah. He then started
and I remember physically hitting him, of which there was no retaliation from the guy. Mm. As a 13-year-old boy, 14, you know, nearly 14 years of age, I was the same as every boy in this city. I had a dream of being a footballer. And every child who has a dream, to me, should be able to try and achieve that dream without having to go through sexual abuse or being around sexual predators. Barry Bunnell, to me, was not only a dangerous man, and he still is a dangerous man, but most of the lads that were involved in his coaching and being involved in the squads that he coached over the years will find this very difficult, and hopefully by what's going on we're going to get some results.
Mm-hmm. When you told him where to go, he mm-hmm. then started the mind games. He would tell you he was going to play you, then he was going to drop you, then you turn up at games on a Sunday, your mum would drive however many miles to take you there, and you'd be standing on the sidelines and never get on.
Yeah.
And that was the start of him trying to isolate you. What else did he do, Jason?
Yeah, he detached me from the group by playing mind games with me. But like the lads have said, because you're following a dream, you're prepared to go through with it. The difference, and why I feel different to these lads, is that I wasn't prepared to put up with that. I love the game of football. I thought to myself, there's other ways around this. Barry Bonnell isn't the be-all and end-all of getting me to where I want to go. And if I have to go around the houses, I'll go to another team. I'll try something a little bit different. Mm-hmm. Because as he tried to detach me from the group by fabricating stories of me amongst my teammates.
Well, he said that you'd stolen money from one of your teammates, didn't
he? Yeah, yeah. He took us down to Norfolk for a Canary Cup tournament, which at the time my father was, you know, a working class man who had to pay for this trip. Mm. And as it usually was, we'd come home with a trophy and there was no trophy. The team had been dropped. The team had been defeated. And my father just said to me, well, why haven't you played? I said, well, do you really want to tell your parents that you've been accused of being a thief?
Mm. But I want to ask you guys, if Andy hadn't spoken out, would you have ever come forward?
Not in a million years. You know, I keep telling Andy this. What he's done is so brave, inspirational. It's, you know, in our opinion, for what he's done now, is absolutely fantastic what he's done. Mm-hmm. So brave, you know. I've been calling him, he's like my new brother.
What would you say, Chris?
It was locked way back in my mind and I'd forgotten about it. I would never have come forward if I hadn't seen Andy on telly.
But what was it about him speaking about his experiences that inspired you to do the same?
Just because I know what he has been through, because I've been through exactly the same and all the lads have been through the same. Mm. And this has got to stop. Mm. And the only way that I could help is to come forward.
Mm. You seem quite strong, Chris, if you don't mind me saying.
Yeah, a lot of people have said that, but I don't know if I'm that strong, I don't know. Deep down, I don't think I am, but I'm a funeral director, I see lots of horrible things, so that's probably made me a little bit stronger than the rest of the lads.
Mm. What would you say to Andy?
I love Andy to bits, and I'm here because of him.
Mm. Andy, you've done a quite remarkable thing, you know.
I was totally overwhelmed, you know. I've got... Last week I was on here, I was on my own, and I was so scared. But I knew that they were here. I've got, honest to God, Victoria, I can't thank the public enough and the media, and more importantly, the lads for backing me up, you know? I'm just totally overwhelmed.
Yeah. I want to ask you all about parents, your parents letting you stay over at a coach's house. I'd like to think that would never happen today. What was different about back then?
From my perspective, I'll come together now. My perspective is that, I've said it before in other interviews, that the parents didn't know. Mm. They didn't know, and they are also victims in this, you know.
Correct.
My mum and dad
absolutely
in tears last night because they actually realised for the first time that they're actually victims as well in this. And they are.
Is it feasible that other adults at the time really didn't know what was happening?
Impossible. At the football clubs, I don't believe it for 1 minute. I believe there was a conspiracy, there was a paedophile ring, and there was people at those football clubs that had duty to look after the welfare of young boys coming through their system. This is their potential future stars, and their future stars are being sexually abused and sexually assaulted by a member of their staff.
Steve, what do you think? Is it possible other adults really didn't know?
I don't honestly know.
Until Bunnell's arrest?
I honestly don't know, really, to be honest with you.
Chris?
I think members of the club, they knew what was going on. They knew what was going on, but it was just swept under the carpet.
You're talking about senior players?
Senior players.
Senior management?
Senior management. And the top as well.
Is this as big as Savile?
I think Savile looks like a choir boy compared to this fella and what's going on right now. Let me tell you.
As I said,
this
Victoria,
is so big.
Yeah, as I said,
so
I said on Channel 4 last night, I'll tell you a story that this is chilling. Somebody rang me up and said, do you remember going to Gran Canaria? And I did it myself as well. And he said, there was 7 of us that went away. And he said, do you know what? We went for 7 days with 7 of us. And he had one every night.
Do you know why you didn't talk to each other as boys?
It wasn't
then
a thing to be done, was it, lads?
No.
No.
From being 11 years of age, you didn't discuss things like that. Because the dream would have burst. And lads just concentrated on improving football.
There is one, just Victoria, that just to show you that this is how it was a written rule. I remember being on a train at the age of 13, and I've spoken to this lad, and he's 25 years since he's come out, and we were sat on a train, and he said, do you remember, Woody, do you remember? And he looked at me and I looked at him, and we both knew. And we eye contact, and he said, you knew, didn't you? And I said, yeah, I knew. But the rest, we didn't talk to each other.
Could it have been prevented?
Yeah.
Chris?
I think, yeah, it could have been prevented, but way back then, there was no laws.
No.
You just went with it.
Up till 1990, whenever it was, he was first arrested. If you would have done a background check in those days, as it is today, he might have been OK.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he wasn't caught.
Yeah.
So what we're saying is we've got a system in place at the moment whereby one of trust, until you become an offender, which obviously carries victims, then you can get away with whatever you want to do.
After Bunnell's conviction in 1998 and George Ormond in 2002, that's the Newcastle United connection, as far as I can see, there was no effort made by any club or the FA to try to investigate whether there were other alleged victims, whether there were other offenders. What do you think of that, Chris?
I just think it's shocking. Shocking. It's like everything that we've been through has been brushed under the carpet. And this is why we're here today, to bring it out and to make people aware. And hopefully others will come out and join us.
Steve, what do you think about the fact that there was no wider inquiry from those within football to try to find out if others had been affected?
I'm gobsmacked, really. All the organisations that are supposed to be responsible for, you know, for football and looking after children, they've got a right and duty to protect us. So all the appropriate authorities, down to the police, everybody, the whole of football just needs ripping apart and say, as I said before, this can never, ever happen to any young footballer again. You know, it's, you know, us four, there's others who've been brave enough to come out now. We're all going through a lot of pain at the moment, but if we can prevent anything else happening to any other young children, you know, me personally, I'll die a happy man then.
What do you want to happen now, Andy?
I've got this endeavour to go with this. I'm not going to stop. And I've spoke to the FA, and it's a passion inside my stomach that I'm going to do everything I can to help those young kids. And I won't stop. It's like Steve said there. I will die a happy man now. And I'm going to do everything I can possibly to help people. And all I've ever wanted in life is to help people. You know, and for me as well, I'm so emotional because last week I was sat in here on my own. And now I've got these guys, and I've got so many people. I've worked so hard this last week. And I just encouraged. I know there's more out there, Victoria, I know there is. And they can do it. They really can do it, you know?
In the world of football, let's speak to the former sports minister, David Mellor. He joins us from central London. Good afternoon to you. First of all, obviously you were previously a sports minister. Had you had any inkling that a story like this might emerge at some point? Are you coming to this completely fresh today?
I am, and may I make two observations about that? When I was a Home Office minister in the 80s, it makes me sound very ancient, but sadly that's the case. You know, we knew then about, say, the paedophile information exchange, which was trying to promote sexual relations with children as being normal. And because we knew about them, we were able to take action. Some of their leaders were imprisoned, others fled abroad. In 1997, which again is ancient history for many, I was made chairman of the Labour government's football task force. And for 2 to 3 years, we took evidence about things in the game. And one thing I remember, for instance, was racial abuse within football. And we said, and the law was indeed changed, that at one time you had to have two people or more being racially abusive. Otherwise, it wasn't a criminal offence. We changed that. But, you know, while we were asking people to bring forward issues in the game, no one mentioned this. So it really has come as, frankly, as someone who's loved football for all of my life, a real shock.
The coaches and people working with young people in whatever sport obviously are in a position of power. And sometimes the young person feels in awe of them. How do you address that relationship in a redress the balance of power?
Yeah, well, obviously that is true. And of course, the people who have primary responsibility for that, first of all, the coaches themselves to show integrity. I mean, look, from when I was a kid, one was always warned to watch out for scoutmasters, you know, but you were never warned to watch out for football coaches. So the first line of attack is to make sure that coaches have proper integrity and are not involved in a game for sexual reasons. Then it's the duty of the club who employs coaches to be absolutely sure that these men will not abuse the trust that young people have in them. And then, of course, it's for parents and others to be sure that what is happening to their child is appropriate, and to ensure that their child is warned to say if anything inappropriate is happening. Because you're absolutely right about one thing. You know, there are a lot of kids, and it's sad because, you know, when a successful footballer comes through, it's wonderful for him, it's wonderful for his family, it's riches all the way. But of course, for every one really successful footballer, there are 50 to 100 who start down that road who aren't successful. And we have to be sure that not only do they not feel grave disappointment at not being successful footballers, but they are not scarred for life by the experiences of being a vulnerable child wanting to do the thing the coach wants, because the coach will make your career or break it. And of course, if coaches want them to do something totally inappropriate, that's wrong. But of course, the one thing I would like to say, there's always the rush for people to say, well, we must change the law. The law is quite clear that if men, whether they're football coaches, schoolmasters, scoutmasters, just someone they meet in the street, abuses a child, that is against the law. But it's for the football authorities to be totally certain that what goes on in the game is properly regulated. And it's obvious that, you know, I suppose we were all a bit asleep at the wheel because this just stayed below the surface.
Do you think then that the bodies involved haven't been vigilant enough? And now that this has come to the fore today, we're hearing from Cheshire Constabulary that more cases are coming to their attention. Are you confident that the processes are now in place to prevent this happening today in 2016?
Not remotely. You know, I remember again, stretching back into ancient history, when I was the minister responsible for trying to curb the misuse of drugs, there were lots of people who would say, oh, we don't have a problem here. And as I used to was able to say with confidence then, because we knew about the scale of the drug problem in the 80s, say, I was able to say to them, well, the reason you haven't got a problem is you're not looking for one. You don't find it. It doesn't mean you haven't got a problem. It just means you're not vigilant enough. And I think that I find it very distressing that people really are not inquisitive enough. I think a number of those who are now speaking out, and you know, one has every reason to believe what they say, the position of a coach in the life of an ambitious child who probably has got ambitious parents who dream of watching him on Match of the Day or Sky Sports One every week, you know, they are very vulnerable people. And football needs to just wake up to this. But if I can be brutally honest with you, you know, much as I love football, I don't particularly love those who administer the game. The FA is a notoriously unfit-for-purpose organisation that never discovers anything until it happens right under their nose, and even then doesn't do much about it. And I think this is just another one to add to that rather sad list.
Just very briefly, what would your advice be to parents? I'm one of those parents, all my children involved in sporting activities.
Yeah.
What can they do to comfort themselves, really, ensure themselves that, you know, they are doing the best by their child?
I think all they can do is advise the child that it's a funny old world, and that there are some people who do not have the best intentions in mind for children, and to have the kind of relationship with their child where the child will tell them what's going on. I also think parents should actually meet the coaches, should actually meet the people who run the club, shouldn't just allow their kids to run off for a Saturday training session or whatever. They should actually take the trouble to acquaint themselves with what's going on. Just as, you know, I used to tell my kids, if someone offers you a lift, don't ever accept it. You know, even in those days, we were worried about things, but the world today is so much more complicated. We know so much more about what awful things are going on. It's a heavy duty on parents, but they, you know, most sensible parents, as I'm sure you do, will discharge that.
David Mellor, great advice. Meet the coaches, know who they are. Thank you.
Police, who've said, we can confirm that a growing number of disclosures have been made in relation to non-recent child sexual abuse linked to football. These have included allegations made against more than one individual. Officers continue to contact all those individuals who've disclosed information. We understand that this is an extremely difficult and emotive subject and hard to talk about, but anyone who's been directly affected by this is encouraged to contact police. And you'll be able to watch an extended version of Victoria Derbyshire's interviews with the former footballers, and that's in a special programme at 8:30 p.m. here on BBC News.
Now, Scotland Yard has said it will change its response to child protection cases after a scathing report into its handling of child abuse and sexual exploitation. The Inspectorate of Constabulary criticised the handling of three quarters of the cases it examined and said there was an indefensible lack of leadership on the issue, with no single officer in charge. Richard Slee reports.
This report contains some of the most scathing criticism ever for a police force from its watchdog. It found that nearly three quarters of the 374 cases it examined were inadequately handled. There were unacceptable delays in obtaining evidence. and a failure to take some cases of missing children seriously, with local officers often unaware of registered sex offenders living in their area. Inspectors also referred 38 of the cases they examined back to the force because of concerns there could be a continuing risk to children.
What we don't have evidence for, because we weren't looking for, is any specific crimes or damage to children that happened as a result of these failings. What we can say with confidence is that children were kept at risk, at higher risk, for longer than they should have been, and were put in more danger than they should have been.
The Metropolitan Police has apologised for its failings and says it's already identified a number of areas that need improvement.
This report says some really challenging things to us about investigations that we have not done as well as we could have done. And we need to look at that, and we need to learn from that, and we need to use this to build on the work that we're already doing to try and make our services as protective as we can for children.
This is the third time, though, in as many weeks that the competence and judgment of Met officers have been called into question. There were failings identified in Operation Midland, the inquiry into an alleged high-level paedophile ring. The Met will be inspected again next year to see if it's succeeding in providing better protection for children in London. Richard Slee, BBC News.
Well, let's talk now to John Brown from the NSPCC, who can join us from Plymouth. Thank you very much indeed for being with us. What do you make of this report and these serious failings that have been exposed in the Met's handling of these child abuse cases?
Well, this report makes for really grim reading. As the Home Office Policing Minister, Brandon Lewis, said, this HMRC report is the most damning, most critical report ever produced. Into, you know, the UK's largest, most well-resourced police force. It's really shocking, to be honest, the extent to which these failings have contributed to a real breakdown in the way in which child protection is managed across the Met Police area. There need to be urgent changes and urgent improvements. It's encouraging to see that the Met are obviously now taking some steps to address that, but in the light of previous child protection and child sexual exploitation scandals elsewhere in the country, it is surprising and shocking to see that the Met have not learned from that and already taken steps to ensure that they've got the proper processes and structures and resourcing in place.
Are you worried that these failings are not unique to the Metropolitan Police, that these are perhaps replicated in other police forces around the country? And are there institutional problems, do you think, within the wider police that that are responsible for these sort of failures?
Well, our experience at the NSPCC is across the UK is that police practice inevitably varies. We're aware of some excellent police practice, and I think we're pretty clear now what needs to be in place, whether it's in the police or in local authority children's services or elsewhere. There needs to be really clear leadership. And there needs to be a clear, identified lead on child protection. That wasn't the case in the Met, with a really clear line of accountability. And there needs to be good quality training for frontline officers. And that, if you like, that strategic lead needs to find its way right down to the front line to ensure that officers know what they're doing, that they understand the complexities of child sexual abuse and sexual exploitation. They understand that when a child makes a disclosure and then perhaps retracts, because that often is the case in sexual abuse because of the grooming process and the pressure that the child's under, that they don't just write it off and think, well, then we'll close the case. Really important to ensure that local officers on the ground understand that, and that the senior officers and leadership really support a proactive approach to dealing with these complex problems within child protection.
And let me also ask you about this unfolding scandal from the world of football. Allegations that the scale of the abuse potentially could be even worse than with Jimmy Savile. What are your thoughts on that? And I know the NSPCC has its own hotline on this.
Well, the FA asked us to set up this helpline, which we did, you know, within a matter of hours. That's now set up. We're taking calls. It is, again, shocking to see the extent to which people are now coming forward. Huge bravery on the part of these players and ex-players to come forward and talk about what's happened. Again, it does rather exemplify the dynamics of sexual abuse, particularly within professional sport and professional football in this instance, where there are so many reasons why it would be difficult for a young player to disclose what's happened. Incredibly brave for them to come forward, and now we really need to get on the front foot in pro football and indeed in other sports to make sure that good whistleblowing is in place and there's absolute zero tolerance approach to any form of grooming or abusive behaviour, and that young people know that when they speak up about it, they won't be judged, they will be heard, they will be listened to, and steps will be taken to make sure that they're safe.
All right, John Brown from the NSPCC, thank you so much for talking to us today. Thank you.
Says it's received allegations about historical sexual abuse in football against more than one person. It comes as former Tottenham and England midfielder Paul Stewart told Sky News he was convinced he had to put up with sexual abuse as a young boy if he wanted to achieve his dream of becoming a professional footballer.
Sometimes I think to myself, why have you come out and done this? And other times, I'm glad that I came out. But overall, I would say it's the right thing to do, just so that we can help others that maybe that may have suffered this, maybe going through it even now. I can't believe for one minute that it's only football that is subject to this problem that has been brought out over the last week. The effect it's had on my family life over many years has been heart-wrenching for me, to keep that locked up. The fact that I had to turn to drugs and drink just to block it out, and then the suffering that I guess my children and my wife I've gone through in terms of the fact that I've been, you know, devoid of any sort of emotion. I see other parents able to hold their kids, to cuddle their kids. That's what I think they've missed out on, and you know. I keep seeing words of hero and proud from my children, my three children, and my wife, but I think they're the heroes really, because they have lived through this for so many years.
And do you believe there may have been a network?
I can't say to you 100% that I know there was a network. I do know that some of these coaches knew each other. So people are going to naturally put two and two together and maybe assume that there might be a network. What I do know is, and do believe, there are more coaches, and there are hundreds of people that have suffered at the hands of these what people keep describing as monsters.
Sky's Ian Woods is here. Incredibly brave when you hear the words of the former footballers who have come out, who've waived their right to anonymity. How did the allegations first come to light?
Well, it's all thanks to Andy Woodward. Andy Woodward started his career at Crewe Alexandra, went on to play for Bury and also for Sheffield United as well. And he was the first person to talk about being abused by the serial paedophile Barry Bennell. That led to other fellow professionals like Steve Walters and David White coming forward to say they had also been abused by Bennell. And as you heard, Paul Stewart has now come forward as well to say that he was abused by a different football coach. And today, two more players have also come forward to say they were abused by Bennell. Chris Unsworth and Jason Dunford did not make it into the professional ranks as footballers. They were abused as children, and some might think that perhaps it was their abuse which prevented them from making it at the very top level of the game.
So who is Barry Bennell? What can you tell us about him?
Well, Barry Bennell is 68 years old now, and he was first, 62 years old, and he was first actually convicted of offences in the United States. But between 1998 and 2015, he was convicted three times and served three prison sentences for various allegations later proven of sexual offence. He's currently released on licence, but of course is banned permanently from football.
And how widespread is this? I mean, we're starting to see these allegations spreading out further, aren't we?
Yeah, I mean, Crewe Alexandra is where the centre of it is, because that's where Barry Bennell was most active, and in that part of the world. But we're also hearing allegations made against a possible coach connected with Newcastle United. And Barry Bennell, because he worked throughout the Northwest region, was also linked with other clubs, including Manchester City. So they are also mounting an investigation. Cheshire Police, as we've heard, say that allegations of come to light involving more than one possible perpetrator. So that suggests a wider, perhaps, network there. Greater Manchester Police, so they say they haven't had any specific allegations relating to their area, but a lot of police forces are now got a very open mind to this, particularly because the national helpline set up by the NSPCC has been attracting dozens of phone calls.
And Ian, we're talking about this now, but at the time that these offences are alleged to have occurred, it was a very different climate, wasn't it?
It was. I mean, it doesn't sound like a lifetime ago, does it? You know, 20 years ago. But at the same time, this was pre-Jimmy Savile and before we ever realised how bad child abuse could be. Certainly, this was when he was first convicted, Barry Bennell, in 1998. It was reported at the time and everyone thought that it was perhaps an isolated incident. Nobody really wanted to look wider than that and see perhaps how widespread it was. And the systems weren't in place to deal with it. Now, the various football associations around the UK do all have very strict stringent rules now in dealing with children, both in terms of who can be a coach, who can work with them, and how they're worked with as well, which covers everything, including how people can have showers together and changing room facilities together. If it's a club that deals with both adults and children, then they can't be there at the same time. Whether those regulations can ever be breached, nobody can say that anything is 100% foolproof. But there does seem to be in place systems now which allow people to say with greater confidence that a Barry Bennell couldn't act in the way he did 20 years ago.
Ian Woods, thank you.
Great career. Who do you turn to share what you know? And I think that's one of the questions football has to look at. And not to say to young people, well, you know, you've not only got to come forward and make the allegation, but you've got to be able to bring all the proof and evidence with you as well, which might be difficult to do. Where are the safe places where people can come forward and share this information? And the FA need to look back to see where were mistakes made in the past, were clues overlooked, was not enough done to investigate a problem that may have been perceived. And looking at football today, are we sure that we've got the right systems in place that would create those safe spaces where someone could come forward and share what they know?
I mean, you as chairman of the Culture and Sports Committee, do you look at what's happened over the last few years and wonder whether this terrible problem of child abuse might have extended to other areas of public life as well? We've had it clearly in the media with Jimmy Savile. We've heard of it in children's homes back in the 70s, at a music college. Now it appears with young boys playing football. And do you have fears that, in fact, there was something that was going on 30 years ago that may have been much more pervasive than we realised?
Well, I think that's a perfectly understandable conclusion to draw from these sort of terrible developing stories. But I think if there are common threads, and certainly common threads that should give us cause for concern, it's that in past cases there were hints, suggestions, maybe some people came forward with allegations and they weren't taken seriously enough. Not enough was done to investigate these things properly at the time. And that has been one of the lessons that has come out of some of those other affairs. And that's why I think in this case in sport, in football, you know, we need to look back at were there mistakes in the past that meant these things weren't looked at properly, people didn't confront the real issues that were in front of them. And they hope they would go away. And if that was the case, that's a very serious matter and certainly requires investigation. I, as chair of the Select Committee, will be writing to the Football Association to ask them to explain how these things were looked at in the past and how they're going to deal with the situation now moving forward.
And Mr. Collins, can you be confident that there are safeguards in place now? Because parents watching this, who've got children involved in sport or in other cultural areas, might be worried.
Well, there will be concerns. I think that's why that we want to hear more about what the FA has to say about this too. But these allegations have centred on the incredibly serious matter of child sexual abuse, which is, you know, it's a crime that can't really get much more serious. But I think we should also consider, you know, bullying or other bad treatment of young players who are in a position of trust, you know, working for, you know, coaches and clubs where they put all their hope and faith in those coaches and clubs, and are they always, you know, looked after as well as they possibly could be, even if the relationship is not an abusive one? I think we should just, you know, take this opportunity to review again the whole culture and nature of the way sport works with young people.
Well, that was Damien Collins, who's the chair of the Culture and Sports Committee.
A little earlier on today, the Mayor of London, Sadiq Khan, said the points raised in the report would be addressed.
The report from the HMIC into how the Met Police failed children and particularly vulnerable children is extremely distressing and highly critical. And that's why I've already spoken to the Home Secretary, the Deputy Mayor for Policing, and spoken to the Minister for Policing. And we have a detailed action plan to make sure the points raised by the HMIC are addressed.
Can the public still have confidence in the Met when it comes to tackling child abuse?
The report is extremely distressing, and there can be no excuse for some of the failings identified by the HMIC report. As a consequence of the HMIC report, it's quite clear that we now need to get rid of the crude targets that the previous mayor had for the police to follow. And I can confirm I'll be getting rid of those targets that the previous mayor had. I can also reassure your viewers that the new draft police and crime plan that we're going to publish shortly will have at the heart of it the need for the police to protect vulnerable people, and that includes children. On Monday next week, we'll have a public scrutiny session looking at the HMIC report. And I can also tell your viewers that will shortly be announcing an independent panel of child experts, including academics, who will be supporting the police in this crucial task. We're also going to take on board the lessons from the HMIC report and have a senior police officer in charge of making sure we take action, because we can't afford any vulnerable person, particularly a vulnerable child, to carry on being let down in the future as they have in the past.
Why has it taken this report to be a wake-up call in this area? Shouldn't the mayor's office have known how bad the situation was?
Well, I agree, that's a question for the previous mayor to answer and the previous deputy mayor for policing. I'm quite clear, it's unacceptable. We've got to make sure there's zero tolerance towards these sort of crimes. Look, this report is damning. It shows that victims of crime, children, were let down by the police. It shows that when children went missing, the police didn't take action. It shows that the police were crudely and perversely using their resources to target the seven targets rather than looking after vulnerable Londoners, vulnerable children.
And there have been criticisms of the Met in terms of Operation Midland, criticisms in terms of the Stephen Port murders. The pressure is on, isn't it, for the new commissioner when he or she takes over from Bernard Hogan Howe?
Hello, what's quite clear is that the Met Police Service do a remarkable job every day. Literally, there are thousands of police officers who go to work each day and risk their lives to look after us and keep us safe. But things have gone wrong. We've got to make sure we learn from the lessons, whether it's the Henriquez report, whether it's the HMIC report today. I'm quite clear that the Home Secretary and myself have an important task in making sure that the appointment we make of the next Met Police Commissioner takes on board the challenges London faces to keep us safe every day of the week, but also recognising actually being the Commissioner of the Met Police is a great job, because you're leading great officers in the greatest city in the world.
Others have come forward anonymously. The NSPCC helpline receiving 50 calls in the first hours of opening. We're in a very different time now, post Jimmy Savile,
yes,
aren't we, where we do talk about this more openly. But going back to 20 odd years ago, what was the climate like? How difficult would it have been then for a young player to speak out about this, and how would it have been received?
I can't really answer that. I wasn't involved in the sport at that time, but what I can tell you is that when it's possible for a child to go into an academy around that time at age six and remain in that academy until 16 and then do an apprenticeship for 2 years as a sort of semi-professional footballer that's looking to make it in the professional ranks, and every single one of those years there's a cut and players get cut. So I think what happens is that they find out very, very quickly that they need to make sure that they're liked by certain coaches. And I think because of that, we get into an environment where there's the possibility of these kind of things happening, especially back 20 years ago when the same restrictions were not in place about, or the same guidelines were not in place on how to coach a young footballer.
Yeah, and we're talking about a young footballer, a young boy potentially making an allegation against somebody in a position of authority,
yeah,
and responsibility, aren't we?
We are, and I think you need to remember that the proportion of players that make it from the academy into the professional ranks is extremely small. So if the player wasn't believed, or if the player was seen as a troublemaker, it would be very easy for him to be replaced in most cases. So I think, you know, we need to keep that in mind. There's an awful lot of pressure on the player not to come out and cause trouble, and I think that's a very relevant factor.
Yeah, and we also heard in the interview from Paul Stewart the decision to come forward and speak, that he wanted to discuss it with his family first. And there are many who have talked in the past, previous abuse victims, about that desire to protect their families, not wanting to hurt their families with these claims and by telling them the truth.
Yeah, I think the football environment is quite unique in terms of parents are asked to stay away from the training event or stand some distance away. So I think, therefore, the coach is very often perceived as somebody who's got an equal amount of authority. And as they move away from the parent, there could be perceived some kind of guilt in terms of on the player's part, really.
Yeah, I mean, certainly Paul Stewart talking about the drugs, the drink, the struggling to show emotion to his wife and children, guilt that he had put them through that. Guilt, I feel so guilty for them having to suffer my problems over the years. James Beale, thank you very much indeed for talking to us this afternoon
here
on Sky News.
Thank you.